West.
Unfortunately, I found out they meant Sydney, Australia, not Sydney, Cape Breton. However, I don't feel there's a whole lot of difference in the two places. We have a beautiful bridge overlooking our city. We have no opera house. We have things that are similar. Hey, how's it going? Thanks. It's a small city, but it's a great one. I grew up here, enjoyed it. Looking forward to representing Sydney, in Sydney.
The biggest influence in my sport initially would have been my dad, because I was introduced to the sport by him. But the biggest influence in my career would be my mom. For sure, she's the reason, you know, I want to win. And as soon as the fight's over, she's the first person I call. My strengths in boxing would be my boxing ability. I'm not a fighter in there, I'm a boxer. I don't take one to give one. I hit and move, I counterpunch, and I don't get drawn into wars. I just, you know, when I have to buckle down and fight, I'll use my heart, and I won't take, you know, a backseat to anyone. I'm in there to win. I think what I enjoy most about boxing is the individuality of the sport. What do I like least about my sport? I'd have to say getting hit. That's about the biggest downfall for me. When I started, I was coaching an athlete. But outside the, you know, the ring, we just pals, hang out. We play a lot of golf. Wayne and I, like I said, we're great friends. We do a lot of things together, both, you know, inside the ring and then when we get home outside. So, you know, with that kind of relationship, it doesn't take long to build success.
There's a strange relationship when you look at the success we have in the ring, but we have a great friendship outside the ring. In the gym, we're very professional. He doesn't question my authority, and if he does, I give him the answer, and any concerns I have with him, I don't mind telling him the difference.
I just can't wait to be there and experience the Olympic Games. I think I have a very good chance of winning that gold medal. I think that I've earned it, and it's my time. I'm not just going there as a spectator, I'm going there to win.
Scott McIntosh of Canada, set now for his light middleweight preliminary against Saki Obika of Cameroon. There he is. It just passed 5:30 in the morning in Cape Breton, and there's a hall in Sydney full of Scott McIntosh supporters. His father, Lambert, mother, Paulette, lots of family and friends, and a big screen TV. They've been waiting all night and all morning for this moment. Hello, Sydney. Your boy is in the ring.
Yes, he's on you.
Saki Obika of Cameroon, 21 years old, only a few international bouts on his record, one gold in the African Championships in Cairo last year to qualify for the Olympics. We know all about Scott McIntosh, won a tough silver in the Pan Am Games in Winnipeg. He led the Cuban, Jorge Gutierrez, going into the final round, but the fight was stopped late in that final round because McIntosh had a bloody nose. Aside from that, his defense in that fight was brilliant. Now, Coach, you made the point earlier today that McIntosh will not have to look for Saki Obika.
And right off the bat, you see Obika comes right out to the center of the ring, and he's the one putting the pressure on, and he'll be there for McIntosh to counterpunch. So McIntosh will have to do that. Wait for him, lull him in, try to make him throw, and then fire back counterpunch combination.
Scott McIntosh's four-year plan has so far worked to perfection. Won his first national title at the best possible time, 4 years out from Sydney. He focused clearly on these games, devoted all his time and energy to making it here, and here he is.
Obika tries that right hand right over the top of the lowered left jab of Scott McIntosh. Scott's got to double up on that jab. Don't throw one and give the opportunity for the guy to throw the right hand back. Good hand held high from Scott McIntosh.
Scott's got about 85 fights on his record, 70 of those wins.
Good straight right hand downstairs to the body scored from Scott McIntosh against the taller Obika.
Two 3-point lead now for Scott McIntosh.
Nice
efficient boxing by him in the first round, Coach.
Nice and smart, bringing the opponent to him and counterpunching. That's exactly what he needs to do. Exploit the inexperience of Bika. The referee taking long again to get inside and break these guys up, and you get these little silly slaps that go on. Makes a referee lose control of the fight that way. Bika taking big swings and McIntosh has gone to safety. Back to the center of the ring, Scott McIntosh.
McIntosh proving very elusive for Sakio Bika in this first round, and so McIntosh has the lead by two.
Tu as le bras arrière, prêt à tirer. Le bras avant, là. Tu arrives, fin, tu coupes et tu suis avec la droite. Ne te jette pas sur lui, sois équilibré. Okay.
Says he wants that left hand up there high and he wants to turn it over into a hook. He wants the lead hand out in front of him.
Okay. Okay. Boxing good. Looks strong out there. Okay.
Scott McIntosh started out at the Sydney Boxing Club. Francis Morrison, I'm sure, is watching this. And Scott now trains with Wayne Gordon at the Citadel Club in Halifax. That's Wayne in Scott's corner. Second round underway. McIntosh holding a 2-point lead. Going to send Scott back to his corner.
They're going to take a look at that little nick under Scott's eye.
Let's hope this does not become a factor. Harken back to what happened at the Pan Am Games in Winnipeg. I mentioned that earlier. That fight, a tough one against Gutierrez, stopped because of a bloody nose. Now Bika on the attack.
They're gonna have to get some pressure on that cut in the corner, get the towel on it, get Q-tip on it, get the end swell on it. Don't let
that exchange. Bika is back to within one.
Now this turning into a wrestling match. Headgear now has come undone from Bika. The same headgears they've been having the problems with.
They may call on the doctor to have a look at that cut.
Fine.
Doctor gives it a wipe and says the fight can't continue.
Now
Bika has to have
to
his headgear adjusted.
Fixed.
So things dragging just a bit here in the second round. We're only 30 seconds in. Sydney Scott McIntosh clings to the 1-point lead.
See, this is why this has happened now. The ref's not getting in there and calling the clinches and getting these guys broken, and you're going to get it turned into a street brawl like this with a lot of pushing and slapping and hits behind the head. Right hand from Bika, left hook counter from McIntosh. Left hook from McIntosh again.
2 points on those left hooks for McIntosh. Now it's a 3-point lead.
Like we said at the outset, the Cameroon fighter Bika is going to be very strong, and he certainly is proving to be strong. Scott McIntosh doing all he can to stay in there with him on the inside.
Scott's retiring from boxing after
this game. Flagrant shots behind the head.
That Scott's retiring from boxing after these games. Naturally, the goal is to go out in a big way, and right now he's got a 3-point lead in his debut at the Olympic Games.
Oh, good left hook from McIntosh on the inside.
Boy, we've seen quite enough of this, haven't we? He's holding and pushing.
Again, the referee not getting in there nearly in enough time to break these guys. As soon as he sees them locked with their hands around their heads, he's got to be more forceful in the ring. Call the break, separate the fighters. Bika wants to turn this fight into a street brawl, that's to his advantage to do so.
Reed will be safe. And we know Scott McIntosh will have been told what the score is.
You're not home free here, Scott. Bika's a good puncher. You're going to have to be very smart in there. And don't get involved in that wrestling match. Just tuck up, keep your arms nice and in. You keep your arms tucked nice and in, the opponent can't grab you. Here they go. Now they're going to start taking points away. This is a joke, Scott.
He's taking
this
the point away from McIntosh.
Absolute joke.
He took a point away from Scott McIntosh for not keeping his head up.
A horrid performance from this referee. I hope we never see him again in these Olympic Games. McIntosh wants to hang around that blue corner, get his back to those two judges.
Well, that call has Sakio Bika back to within three. Was a 5-point lead. Now it's three. This will be a nervous final minute for all of those watching in Sydney and the Canadian contingent in the Sydney Exhibition Center.
Look at Bika taking the shots at the back of the head as well. And the referee not cautioning him or warning him at all. Total loss of control on the part of the referee. Just letting them wrestle in there, look, throwing each other around, and the ref's not making a move to do anything.
I think survival, mere survival over the last 40 seconds will be the key here. McIntosh just needs to stay out of trouble, and that's exactly what he's trying to do, backing up now. Bika firing, but none of those shots have connected.
You know, this guy's calling them for the wrestling, and he's the one that's making the wrestling go on by not breaking them in time.
There's been a lot of this through this fight. Referee finally decided to
look,
do
another shot in the back of the head.
Right in the back of the head, and now he cautions Bika of Cameroon, does not take a point away.
Scott's into the last 10 seconds here. Right hand over the top for Scott McIntosh.
But it remains 8-5. This is safe now. There were some nervous moments in this fight. There was some concern about that cut, but the bleeding stopped. And McIntosh hangs on for victory in what can only be described as an ugly display.
Terrible fight, and that was because of the referee. I mean, total loss of control from the first round. A shoddy, shoddy, shoddy performance. The worst we've seen here yet at these games, Scott.
Almost like a referee in a hockey game who lets it get totally out of control and decides late in the third he's going to crack down.
But that's just awful. I mean, these guys were wrestling, hitting in the back of the head. Especially Beak. I mean, he was taking shots at Scott McIntosh in the back of the head, throwing him around. And he would not call the break at any time.
8-4-9.
Nonetheless, Scott McIntosh through to the round of 16, where he will get Jermaine Taylor of the U.S., who earlier KO'd Dmitry Usagin of Bulgaria. There is confirmation of the decision. Scott McIntosh gets it on points, 8-5. Some of the crowd don't understand it, but this fight belongs to McIntosh.
We're going to just touch on the celebration we're bound to see in Niagara after this affair for Mike.
The Olympians, presented by Royal Bank.
I was there basically for experience, and I learned a lot. Then when I went to Atlanta, I was there to win a gold medal. But unfortunately, in the quarterfinals against the Bulgarian, a kind of a bad decision. It really didn't sit well with me. And, you know, I took a little bit of time off after that, but, you know, receiving all the faxes and mail from all the Canadians all over the country really meant a lot to me. And they told him, you know, give it one more shot. Go to Sydney. That's what I'm doing now. I got all the experience behind me. I've been boxed for 19 years. You know, I'll be boxing 18 and 19 year olds down there and I've been boxing as long as they've been alive. So I think it's going to come down to experience and the will to win. Oh, being Canadian means everything to me, you know, especially going to the Olympics. Not too many people get to go to the Olympics, and I'm going on my third, so I'm very fortunate. And there's nothing like going in the opening ceremonies for your country. You know, you're one of about 300 athletes from Canada out of, you know, 24 million people in Canada. And you're one of the chosen few. You get to do that walk down in the opening ceremonies, through the tunnel, out on the track, and do your lap. There's nothing like it. It's kind of indescribable. You just get the shivers. Your legs get weak. You're eaten by a dog. I've had that feeling a couple times, you know, at the Commonwealth Games twice, where I'm the gold medal winner. I'm standing on top of the podium, listening to my national anthem blare, and my flag being risen on top of the other flags, the silver and the bronze. And it's a feeling where your emotions run wild, you're crying, and it's a great feeling. And you're just so proud at that moment that you're Canadian and you're representing your country and your colors. Hey, you know, at the previous two Olympics, I haven't won a medal, and it's basically the only major tournament that I haven't won a medal at. So I got a little bit unfinished business from Atlanta. I'm gonna go out and bring some hardware back to Niagara Falls from Sydney.
Mike Strange in for the long run. That's why people love Mike Strange. And Scott Oak, we're going to send the down to you in just a minute in Darling Harbor. Doesn't that remind you of the time you and me and Scott Russell went for a run at the All-Star Game in Tampa and got lost? We were out there running around for 3 hours. A little smoother, that Mike Strange, I'd have to say. You and Russ Amber will take over next. That's it.
Mike Strange and the long road stops in Sydney. This is where he says he'll call it a career, but he says not tonight. And there is Mike Strange's opposition, Nurhan Süleymanoğlu of Turkey. Mike Strange felt he was the victim of a bad decision in the quarterfinals in Atlanta 4 years ago when he lost to the Bulgarians, so he stuck around for four more years to try it again in Sydney. Was the wait worth it? The answer, or part of it, may come tonight.
This is it. This is what he's been waiting for. The maturity, the experience, the wisdom all culminates tonight, Scott.
The experience of Süleymanoğlu rivals that of Strange. Won the 1993 European Championship, silver in the 95 World Championships, silver in the 98 World Cup. It should be clear that Mike Strange has drawn one of the toughest fighters in this class for this preliminary bout.
This certainly was no easy draw for Michael Strange, not by any stretch of the imagination. But you know, with a guy like him and the experience he has, that's not what he's counting on. He knows there's not going to be no easy road to a medal, and he's here and ready, and let's hope he's feeling good and ready to go, Scott.
Big question for Mike Strange is, after coming down with some sort of virus and being sick for the weekend, what kind of effort will he be able to expend tonight against Nurhan Süleymanoğlu? He'll have to summon his best to beat the Turkish fighter. So we're underway. First round of this light welterweight preliminary. Coach Mike Strange is the prototypical Canadian amateur fighter. I'll let you describe what that means.
Well, he's made some adaptations since the last time we saw it. In the past, he used to fight a lot with that peekaboo style. Now, a little more wisdom, a little smarter, uses range a little bit more. There's the ref getting in there, telling them they've got to mix it up. Both guys counterpunchers, both want the other to make the mistake. But that's what you're going to see from Michael Strange. Those hands held high, trying to counterpunch, trying not to give the opposition any kind of an opening. And Scott, I can't reiterate to you enough how important it is for Mike Strange to get his back to those blue ropes. We don't see them in our picture now, right there. Get his back towards those blue ropes and cut off the two judges.
Mike Strange, 30 years old, Canada's most successful active international amateur boxer. almost 300 fights on his resume, 11-time Canadian champion, 3-time Olympian. Now we're into the last minute of the first round. Still waiting for the first scoring shot. Good defense from Mike Strange as Süleymanoğlu of Turkey fires away.
That's where I would like to see Mike stay, right there. Hide from those two judges. Don't let them see the scoring target. Süleymanoğlu is going to try to get into that area himself. Don't you think he doesn't know that?
Does it not look to you, coach, as though they've got identical fight plans?
Sure they do, and that's a similar style from Süleymanoğlu. We see that often, and a lot of the good fighters will do that. They want to be patient and wait for the good, clean shot. It's only with the Americans, the Cubans, where we see them wanting to dominate early, coming out throwing punches. These two guys far, far more technical.
Not many bouts in the Olympic tournament have ended scoreless after one round of boxing, but this one does. For the second round against Nurhan Süleymanoğlu of Turkey, we await the first scoring blow of this fight. Both fighters rather conservative in the first round. How will the fight open up, coach?
The fight will open up, I think, when someone explodes with a flurry and gets the first scoring blow. But I don't want to see Mike standing there, because that'll give an opportunity for Süleymanoğlu to get that scoring blow. Like I just said, look at that. A glancing blow, and it comes up. And why? Because in full vision of the two judges. And I'll bet you Mike doesn't think that punch scored.
That's a point you've made several times throughout the Olympic tournament. A lot of the scoring depends on where you are in the ring.
Good combination from Mike, and then he needs to explode again, get the second attack going before Süleymanoğlu gets set. You get him on the defensive, fire again, a three-punch combination.
Second scoring shot now for Süleymanoğlu. Into the final minute of the second round, and it's become clear that points will be hard to come by. Those could be two big scoring shots for the Turkish fighter.
Got to use those feints a little bit more. That's right. Get him with the right hand. But you see, Süleymanoğlu, where does he go? Right back. Where does he always find solace? Right back with his back to those blue ropes. Look, see, right away, moves away, stays at a distance, trying to work his way around to get into that area before he attacks. Now, look, that's where he's tried to make his move. And he gets the point for it after taking a right hand from Michael Strange.
Strange fired the right over the top. It did not come up, but a scoring shot does for Süleymanoğlu, 3-0. Light welterweight preliminary underway. Canada's Mike Strange from Niagara Falls in the red. We'll have some work to do now to catch up to Nurhan Süleymanoğlu, who's opened up a 3-point lead. All the points coming in the second round.
No matter which way Süleymanoğlu goes, that's where Mike needs to work, right from that area.
Undoubtedly, Strange was told between rounds he was behind. You can see he's trying to force the fight a little bit more now.
Look at Süleymanoğlu right away, retreat to that area and stays there. Through anywhere else he is in the ring, he moves. When he gets into that area, he stands right there. Points come up for him.
Day four was a good one for Canada, with wins by Andrew Cooner at flyweight, Scott McIntosh at light middle. Strange is the fighter, though, the whole team looks up to. Any win is a big one, but it would be a real source of inspiration for the Canadian team if Strange could pull this one out.
Strange has to keep letting the explosive combinations go. Fast hands, good combinations, finish with the left. Look at Süleymanoğlu right away, going back to that area in the ring, and that's where he stops.
Remains a 3-point gap.
Strange trying to fight out on the inside. Again, Süleymanoğlu holding that area with his back to the two judges.
Strange really needs a scoring shot or two to close out this third round.
Stop. Strange is in the right place. If he's going to do it, this is where he's got to do it now.
Caution was to the Turkish corner to remain quiet. Closing seconds of round three. Mike Strange's Olympics and his boxing career will come down, apparently, to the fourth and final round of this fight. Russ, what is Mike Strange's best chance in the fourth round?
He's got to let his hands go, Scott. That explosiveness has to be there. Use the feints. Don't let Soleimanoğlu know what you're going to do. Buzz him. Step, sidestep, feint, and try to get yourself into the area where you've got your back to. I know I keep saying that. I know I keep reiterating it all the time, but it's so important, and it's evident Soleimanoğlu is executing it to perfection. There was the scoring blow that came up for Mike, and as well a scoring blow came up for Soleimanoğlu. Why? Because his back was to the rope. A little tapping blow, they gave it to him.
This is it, the final round of this light welterweight preliminary. Will it be the last 2 minutes of Mike Strange's boxing career? He'll have to go to work now. He's got no choice. It is not an insurmountable deficit.
No, not at all. And look, Soleimanoğlu right away wants to get into that area. That's where Mike's got to get him now, so the two judges can see what Mike is hitting him with. That's where Mike needs to work. And look at Soleimanoğlu, goes right back to the ropes.
Soleimanoğlu knows he's ahead clearly, Russ.
Sure he does.
3-point gap once again. We'll see a lot of this now in the fourth round. Mike Strange chasing Soleimanoğlu around.
And again, where did Soleimanoğlu work? Right near that blue and white corner. Look, right back to it again. That's look, he goes away and then goes back there. Brings Mike this way, and then I will go back to the other area.
Scoring shot for Soleimanoğlu, coach, who said between rounds that Mike Strange's best chance was to let his hands go. He's trying, and look, he expresses his frustration. He wants to engage Soleimanoğlu, who is content to back up. That's the nature of Olympic boxing when the computer scoring's in effect. If a fighter knows he's ahead in the fourth round, he'll back up, and that's what Soleimanoğlu's doing.
There's backing up and there's running. And now the ref is gonna is letting them struggle on the inside. He's gotta make sure that he breaks them right away.
Final minute of the fourth round. Strange's situation has become desperate. He just can't track him down. Again, Strange expresses frustration. Caution now by the referee to remain quiet.
Soleimanoğlu just running around the ring.
A tall order now for Mike Strange, trailing by six, coming up on the final 30 seconds of the fight. Well, we pointed out, coach, in the second round, those 2 points, and in fact, the second round ended 3-0 in favor of Soleimanoğlu, that those might have been big points, and once he got ahead, it was awfully tough for Strange to catch up.
And Soleimanoğlu, with the experience he has, don't you think he doesn't know how to run out the clock and use that ring? He showed he knows how to use the ring offensively as he spent time in that blue corner, and that's where he went on the attack.
And that's it. Strange is not happy. Once again, another display of frustration directed at Nurhan Soleimanoğlu, who was not eager to engage Mike Strange in the fourth round, but you can understand that. And you can also understand Mike Strange's frustration. This is not how he expected his Olympic Games to end.
And you know, we haven't seen a lot of, we've seen some fighters doing, but not a lot of fighters have gone to that backpedaling. They've stuck to their battle plan and fought. Soleimanoğlu just got on his bike and ran. He knew he was ahead, and that's exactly what he was going to do.
Wayne Gordon and his brother Jim in Mike's corner. Game effort from Mike Strange. We mentioned earlier that he was sick over the weekend, but that did not appear to be a factor at all tonight, coach.
He certainly worked hard. He really went out for the win. He was hungry. The heart was there. The adrenaline was pumping. He wanted to go, and you could see it in the frustration that he was showing towards Solimanolu. He wanted to fight.
So here it is, Mike Strange's Olympics and his career. He won't be thinking much about it right now, but it's been a good run. Three straight Olympics, over 300 fights. Can't recall seeing any in which he didn't give his best, including what has turned out to be his farewell fight tonight. Take a bow, Mike.